been married for quite a while. Got a bunch of kids doing faith in style. They'll tell you that you're awesome and you're not alone.
So let's start the show.
Who knew Catholics could be so much fun? Greg and Jennifer and how faith is done. Screwing up and trying and forgiving. Adventures in imperfect living. Adventures in imperfect living.
Greetings, folks. I'm Greg Willits from gregandjennifer.com and rosaryarmy.com.
And I'm Jennifer Willits, his wife.
Coming up on episode 338 of a very special edition of Adventures in Imperfect Living.
We talk more about reverence.
I attended the funeral of a lifelong family friend.
And a very special conversation with Bishop Athanasius Schneider will be on today's program.
You are not going to want to miss this. This is an episode you're going to want to share with your family and friends. And God willing, this episode will help you have a greater understanding and love of our Eucharistic Lord Jesus Christ. So climb into your kneeler and grab your 1962 missile, because episode 338, it's starting right now.
Adventures in a perfect living.
We are so blessed with so many people that support the show by going over to patreon.com/Greg and Jennifer. We say it every week, and it's not just paying platitudes and feeble homage to all of you who are co-producers. You mean so much to us. You make the show go. We call you co-producers because you're making the show happen every week. If you'd like to be a part of our growing co-producer community, please go check it out. Find out all of the different benefits and rewards and extra bonuses you'll get by being a co-producer of the show over at patreon.com/Greg and Jennifer. Thanks to two people who increased their pledges in support of the show this week. Captain Jeff, you're awesome, man, and we miss you. Longtime good friend of ours. And Jim, who we might actually get to meet in a few weeks when we go to our son's wedding. It's very exciting. So we hope that works out. We'll see. We'll be a little bit busy.
Yes. You know, so yes. I will stay in touch about
probably
that.
Won't have a lot of time to visit if that does happen. But we do hope it happens. And so we'll see. All in God's timing. But again, thank you to all of our co-producers over at patreon.com/Greg and Jennifer. And speaking of Jim.
Hey, Greg and Jennifer, it's Jim. And last week's episode of yours had a few different topics of interest to me. The subject of reverence just made me think it might be worth having a very concisely stated sign on the back of your chair or somewhere where people can see it. That would just kind of point out that you want to be reverent in the church. So please, no questions. But, you know, you'd gladly answer questions or talk to people outside the church. Even though a sign like that might be a little bit distracting to people, I think they'd realize, oh yes, we need to be reverent here. And it could actually have a better effect long term on the whole mass going experience for people. The subject of the Byzantine church kind of reminded me of a few summers ago. I happened to be in Milwaukee, Wisconsin one particular weekend and was able to check out the cathedral in a few places, but for the Sunday liturgy, I made it to a Melkite Catholic church, and later that summer, made it to St. Louis for the Great Eclipse, and there was a Ruthenian mission church there, and was able to catch that part of the Byzantine rite as well. And even later that year, I caught a traditional Latin Mass in town here. And, you know, each of these kind of brought out unique and beautiful things. You know, I really wasn't looking at them to say, oh, what's bad about this one or bad about that one. Each one, it's like, here's what I like. Here's what I like about this one. And it was really nice. And I will say, though, that when you flip to a different rite, that's where it really helps. You know, it really stood out the first one I went to. You really don't necessarily know exactly how to follow along with everything, so there it might actually help to ask somebody questions. And kind of going back to the reverence, you might want to ask in a quiet voice and, you know, be respectful, of course. And the great thing is there, you know, if it's a question regarding getting the most out of the liturgy, I think that's still reasonable as opposed to the different questions about equipment and services, that kind of stuff that you were being asked. And then the other thing is productivity. Different times of day can work better for different kinds of activities, so you might want to start figuring out, if you haven't already, when are you at your best and worst when it comes to creativity or the focus and concentration, probably not at 1:30 p.m., for instance, and problem solving, which can kind of depend a little bit on both of those. And yeah, if it's a time like 1:30 when a lot of people aren't able to concentrate as well and they're kind of tired, maybe that's a time to just do menial tasks that don't really require much thought. Anyway, those are a wide range of thoughts I had from your last episode.
I would have a better response to your voicemail, Jim, except it's actually 1:40 right now as we're recording this. So just 10 minutes past when you said people don't have energy to...
No, it's kind of funny. With all the coronavirus thing, and our schedules have gotten flip-flopped, and we started doing the live stream rosaries at 8 o'clock at night. That was keeping us up later. And so in a weird way, because we're sleeping in a little bit longer than we used to, and school's not in session yet, it will be in a couple of weeks, I actually am kind of getting my groove on around 1:30 in the afternoon. That's really when it's sort of kicking in, and I've been lately getting the most work done because it's also the time when I know I'm not going to be interrupted. I know that I don't have to take boys to work. I don't have to go pick up the kids from work. You know, it's like this is a safe zone for me to be able to get work done. So that's kind of why we're recording right now. However, I imagine when school begins and other things are happening that's going to go all flip-flopped, and I'm going to have to figure out my schedule all over again. But the things I was talking about for productivity, that sheet and everything that last week, the daily sheet that I fill out, just it's just such a blessing to have figured that out. And the other day, I just out of the blue, I went, oh, I just thought of three more things I want to add to that, because I'm always writing down exercise and writing. Like I'll write down every day 300 words and you know, try to walk. And I just need to have like check boxes up on the top. That if I get in a minimum of 300 words and the exercise, that I get to check those boxes versus having to write them down every day. Just have this permanent spot for them. So my goal should be to always fill up those boxes before I actually move on to my other things as well. So
you like doing that, closing rings, checking boxes. It feels good because there's just a little part of us that always wants to put that star sticker on some kind of a virtual chart in our brain. Yeah. We like to collect little rewards for good deeds.
Well, what's funny along those lines, you know, collecting rewards for good deeds. Last week when we were praying the live rosary, it was after last week's podcast, and I had talked about finishing up the new Rosary Army website. And I just, as a throwaway comment, talking about the productivity, talking about the website, I had mentioned in last week's show that one of the things that helped me was I was setting goals. It's like if I got certain things done as a rest or reward, I would give myself like these little 15, 20-minute video game breaks and go play Legend of Zelda. Well, someone mentioned that on our live stream rosary. Angie mentioned it. She said that actually, you know, made it so that she liked the site even better because she knew that, you know, Zelda and Link were involved and Nintendo and all that kind of thing. I thought that was kind of amusing. Well, our daughter Lily and our son Ben and me, we all have kind of been trying to figure out, well, what's the next game that we could get for this Nintendo thing? And I'll be honest, in the back of my head, I'm like, I need a new thing that would be a new carrot to dangle in front of me to keep working because I finished that other game. So I'm like, okay, what's the new carrot that would be like my little work reward? Because that worked so well, having the little dumb video game to go play for 15 minutes. It's like, so I got this part of the Rosary Army done, go play a game for 15 minutes. I got this edited, you know, podcast or video or whatever, go do that for 15 minutes and do chunks of it. So there's a game that we've been looking at for a few months, and it was really popular right when the coronavirus thing hit, and people that I know have purchased this and would post about it, and it's a game I just never thought I would ever want to play. It's called Animal Crossing, and there's something about it. I kept asking Lily about it, and I talked to Ben about it, and I just kind of got it in my head that
number one, it would be something where I would get those little rewards of ding, I accomplished little tasks, which I like doing. And it was also thinking this could be something that Lily and I could probably enjoy together. And so, again, this is the way I am about any of these things. I probably overthink every purchase that I make. I don't make spontaneous purchases very often. I mull over it for a long period of time. But you'd also said you had encouraged me to get another video game. And I was like, well, and I almost bought one for the computer. She goes, the purpose is to get you away from the computer. And I said, good point. So that's why I ended up doing the Animal Crossing thing.
Now, on what platform?
This is on like the Nintendo. Oh, wait.
Is the Animal Crossing on all platforms?
No, it's just on Nintendo Switch.
Okay. You have to have the Switch in order to play that game.
Which, again, you know, we got it a few years ago when we had a little bit more money. And now it's like, now we just have this thing that we played all the games. And so we finally bought a new game. So having this, it's been kind of funny along the lines of what you're saying that, you know, that there's these little rewards. But what's so funny about this was the whole premise of this is you basically, the game starts and you're like this little cute, you know, character, and there's animals all over the place. And animals sort of run the world, these anthropomorphic animals that can talk and, you know, they walk around like humans, but they're cute little animals. So there's this a raccoon or something, and they take you on a trip to drop you off on a deserted island, but they're going to be with you there. And they basically have the money, and they will give you a loan, and you can build a house and build up a civilization, and you have beach chairs and palm trees and whatever. You can basically make this be whatever you want. And it's kind of amusing. It is kind of relaxing to do this. But as soon as you get there, they said, okay, well, we need to name this island. What should we name this island? Well, I have a gamer name that I've used for years until one of our sons appropriated it from me. And then I created a new gamer name, and another son appropriated that gamer name from me. And even though that our son Sam appropriated that second gamer name, I still use it as well because I don't think he uses it as much. So I will, in a game, if I have to create a fake name, I create the name Brother Monk. So it sort of has a double meaning, right? A monk you call brother, and brother is a monk. So I came up with that name, Brother Monk. So that's my gamer name. So they said, well, what do you want your name to be in the game? I was like, I don't know. I didn't want it to be Greg because I also knew that you could speak with other people. I'm just going to stick with Brother Monk because also if I do run into real people in this virtual world later on down the road, in some of the games that I play, people actually have asked me, are you an actual monk? And I'm like, I'm not a monk, but I am Catholic. And I'm like, and so I'll even evangelize in the game. So then they say, well, what do you want the name of your island to be? And it's got to be Rosary Army. So I named the island Rosary Army, and it's been the funniest thing. If you are using a phone right now in your podcatcher that shows you the pictures of what we're talking about, look down right now, and I will put a picture in there of what they're kind of saying. They're constantly saying, oh, welcome to Rosary Army. Rosary Army's the best island ever. Everyone wants to be at Rosary Army. And just
cheers,
like,
let's raise a glass and toast Rosary Army.
And it's very amusing. And so then Lily had to join the same island. And so we're both running around on Rosary Army. And she and I were playing, and she designed a actual Rosary Army t-shirt. So then my character is running around, as I do in real life, wearing a Rosary Army shirt. And it's funny because you keep walking in the other day and you looked at the screen and my character is wearing a Rosary Army shirt. And then you looked at me and I'm laying on the bed playing this game and I'm wearing a Rosary Army shirt. You just kind of shook your head and went into the clawfish where all the rosaries are for Rosary Army. And so it was just, we keep doing this. We've made like little banners for Rosary Army, and I have a Rosary Army welcome mat in front of my little virtual house, and it's been kind of amusing. So I have not gotten very far in this. Apparently, in Animal Crossing, you can go and visit other real people's islands, and they can come visit yours. I'm not quite sure how to do that, but if you are a listener and you happen to have gotten sucked into the vortex of Animal Crossing during the coronavirus because you couldn't go anywhere, apparently this game has sold like 10 million copies to desperate people wanting to like have some simple joy in their lives in the middle of quarantining. send me whatever your code is or whatever, and I'll come visit your island, and I'll try to figure out how to send you
an invite,
mm-hmm. so that you can come and visit the Rosary Army Island that has like a total of like 5 palm trees and a chair. That's what I figured out so far.
Or better yet, if mm-hmm. you just know how to do this, just email Greg. Yeah. What email should they send this to you?
You would want to be a part of it as well. feedback@gregandjennifer.com. But I think it's kind of cool. I actually look forward to having some other external people visiting Rosary Army Island once it's discovered. So
Catholics take over. So that's Animal Crossing.
That's how I'll be continuing my productivity trail is by playing Animal Crossing, is apparently the latest game that I will be using for that purpose. Now, to Jim's point about talking about putting the sign out or whatever, we actually got another voicemail about that same subject.
Hi, Greg. I think I have a reasonably easy answer to the unwanted questions at Mass. When they tap you on the shoulder and start to ask their question, smile, hold your fingers to your lips like going shh, point to the tabernacle and nod, and then go on with your prayer. I used to work at a church in here in Minnesota and had experience with this kind of behavior, and this would often work. The parishioner would then wait for me in the gathering space to ask their question, but it didn't break my prayer, and it taught them a little bit of reverence without having to explain, because very often when we're explaining, we're losing. So God bless you, and thank you both for your podcast. This is Karen in Minnesota. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Karen. It's great hearing from you, talking about putting the sign out or whatever. Our new church should be finished being built in the next few weeks. And I haven't talked to our pastor about this, but my intention is to no longer continue doing the live stream filming of the masses once the new sanctuary is complete. We should have, I've been told that there's some sort of already built-in camera that will capture these, you know, webcam live stream things a little bit better than what we had before. My hope is that my services won't be needed in that respect, because I actually miss a couple things. I miss going to Mass with my family and sitting with my family. I haven't done that in months because I'm always doing the live stream. And I miss just praying during Mass. I never get a chance to do that because I'm helping with the live stream, and it's just not the same. So that's how I'm going to be handling it. In the last week, I prayed about it a lot after we talked about it on last week's show, and just the sort of the realization, it's like, okay, I can do this for a few more weeks until the church is finished being built, and then I'll just kind of, you know, it's a good opportunity to phase out from that at that point. You know, and another thing about the whole topic of reverence that I had a lot of time to think about this past weekend. You may recall, I think we mentioned this on the podcast. We definitely mentioned it on the live rosary streams that we were doing back in May, May 4th. A longtime family friend, Mr. Felix, died. And to explain the relationship with the Felixes you probably have someone in your life who you don't remember life without them, some family friend or something like that. And for us, the Felixes definitely fit that bill. When I was a kid living here in Atlanta, there was a cul-de-sac right behind our house, and the Felixes lived on that cul-de-sac. And so our back door butted up to the Felixes' back door. And so if we went to each other's homes, we went from back door to back door. That's how, you know, we went over there.
That's awfully convenient.
I don't know. I honestly don't know if I ever in my entire life ever walked through the Felix's front door. I always went into the back door that went right into the kitchen. And Mr. and Mrs. Felix, they had 3 kids. The kids were older than me. Their kids were more my siblings' ages. Their son, Calvin, I think even took my sister to the prom 1 year. And, you know, Mr. Felix was just a very, very congenial guy. He was very friendly. I told his son Calvin this weekend at the funeral, because again, he died in May, but we just now had his funeral on Saturday. And I told Calvin, I said, the thing about your dad made me feel like I was some sort of superstar celebrity every time he saw me. every time he saw me, he was like, "Hey, Greg, hey." Yeah, I was just like,
he just lit up.
He just, it's like he couldn't believe he was seeing Greg. And I'm like, "Oh, Mr. Felix held me as a baby, probably. I know Mrs. Felix did."
Could you imagine receiving people that way?
That, with that much joy?
That much enthusiasm. And no. It was authentic enthusiasm. There was nothing fake about Mr. Felix's regard toward you in that way.
Yeah, and that was what was so special about him. And so, you know, it was sad to go to his funeral because there was only, I would say, a tenth of who would have normally been at his funeral. There were so many people that didn't go because of all the restrictions and the coronavirus and everything else that went into it. And this was actually at the church where you and I got married 25 years ago. Not in the same, they have a day chapel. The day chapel's the actual sanctuary where you and I got married, and they've since built a new church. But still, it's like every time I go back there, it's like a homecoming, you know? And I get there, and my folks were there, and saw other people that we knew from when we were parishioners at that parish all those years ago, and immediately saw Mr. Felix's son, Calvin, and I hadn't seen their daughters in decades, honestly. And again, they were much older than me. But then Mrs. Felix came in, and I hadn't seen her in a while, in a couple years probably. And she came in, and she was thinner than I'd ever seen her. She always had very meticulously coiffed hair. Her hair was always done. It's always looked the same my entire life.
It makes me think of like that movie, Steel Magnolias with Dolly Parton. And yeah. There was the salon and how Southern women are very particular about the hairspray and the largeness and the grandeur of their hair. It was perfection. So she had very Southern particular, you know, hair that was iconic and white, just
always
white.
And it was, and I seem to remember it being white even when I was a kid. I mean, she just she just had this white Q-tip ball of hair on top of her head. And so it wasn't quite like that. And, you know, you could tell it was flatter. It was just, you know, she looked thinner and she was in a wheelchair because she's had a few falls. And you know, she came in and she looked like a woman who's lost her husband.
Aww.
And, you know, at first her face was strong, and then just people were going up. And even though they weren't supposed to hug her, they're like, "I'm going to hug Mrs. Felix." And she was going to hug them, you know. And she saw me, and first thing she said, she didn't say, "Hi, Greg." She just said, "I love you."
Oh, and she said that to you.
And I'm just like, "I love you too, Mrs. Felix." I said, "I'm so sorry." And, you know, Mr. Felix, it's just like he's just someone I've known my whole life. And I wouldn't even say that I was super close to him. His kids, or I would say in particular, Calvin and Calvin's wife are really close to my parents. My dad is godson to one of their kids, I think.
Godfather,
yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah. And, you know, they've always been a part of my life.
Your families are tied together.
Yeah, and you know, even with all of the moves that we did growing up, you know, I'm originally from Atlanta, and I moved to a zillion different places, and then end up back in Atlanta however many times now. The Felixes are always there. The Felixes are always part of our lives. They just always are. And so it was very sad. And what's interesting is, I didn't know a whole lot about Mr. Felix's past until he died. I didn't know, for example, that, and he was like 87 years old, he actually went to the University of Arizona on a baseball scholarship. He was so good at playing baseball, even back then, he got to go to college on a baseball scholarship. And he even was good enough that he played in farm leagues for minor league baseball. But this, according to his son, on Saturday, you know, at some point he realized he was never going to make it into the major leagues. Ended up going into the military. He learned electronics in the military. And then he spun that into a career working for AT&T for many years. And just, you know, he was a very much an outdoorsman. My brother Paul, who was also very much an outdoorsman from a very early age, Paul gravitated towards Mr. Felix, and I think they had a special relationship. And Paul called me on Friday just to let me know, because Paul has been around so many people at work that have dealt with coronavirus, that it just wasn't safe or prudent for him to come over for the funeral. And I could tell he was, it really, really bothered Paul. And he had called and talked to Calvin and said he wasn't going to be able to be there for the funeral. But going back to the idea of reverence, and we're going to talk about this later on in the show when we speak with Bishop Athanasius Schneider, that one of the things that I'm really starting to want to do something about to help people with, and I'm not quite sure how, is to start fostering a greater sense of the sacred, to truly look at the opportunities that are present and available to us by our extreme reverence to how we act and how we move even. We talked last week about going to a traditional Latin Mass. One of the things that struck us, not because it felt like something that was forced or showy, but something that was so specific that it echoed the reverence and the reverential thing that was happening, was, for lack of a better word, the choreography of the altar servers, of the acolytes at the traditional Latin Mass. They walked in total unison and synchronization. They would stand at the altar, and then when they needed to swap places, they didn't just like crisscross, they took two steps back. And then almost like in this, imagine a triangle angle, they would go more, they wouldn't go side to side, they would go in this crisscross angle, and then they would pivot into opposite sides and then move forward again. It's hard to explain on a podcast, but there was such precision.
And always bowing.
Always bowing.
Anytime.
Yeah, but it was, even their footsteps had a cadence. Their movements were deliberate. When the priest raised the host, the way his arms moved in a certain symbolic pattern and timing even, everything seemed smooth and well-oiled, and it was not some sort of robotic mechanization, but it was more a very precise movement that was just almost perfected in its purpose. And when oftentimes when we go to Mass, there is a discombobulated feeling that I get because some people are kneeling and some people aren't. Some people are holding up their hands and some people aren't. And there's even up on the altar, sometimes you just don't know if you're going to get a jokester deacon or a jokester priest or someone's going to do this, or you just, and there's something special about knowing that things are going to work in a very specific way and that they are meant to operate in that way. And so that's my desire when I go to church. Because when I have experienced those things where very specific actions or very specific words or very specific intonations were used, they can bring about such a powerful emotional and spiritual response from you. This visceral, deep, internal response that can only be described as the stirring of the Holy Spirit within you. That comes not because you manufacture that, but because the sacred is present and undeniable. And when you see the Holy Spirit in action, there's a stirring. And it's when you see something that is just emotional and it makes you well up, unexpectedly well up, because you know of its specialness. And it's very hard to experience that in most masses, especially these days, with the lack of pews, because the pews have been swapped out for plastic chairs and because things are roped off. And at the end of the funeral for Mr. Felix, and it was a nice funeral, I would not say it was particularly... And I don't say this as some sort of ding on the priest or the parish. Again, it was all the things I just said. I mean, it felt coronavirus-y. It felt separated. We were mourning in our own quadrants. It didn't feel right. But then, so here we are in the church, and we're following all of the spacing rules. And then we all afterwards go outside. And then we're all clumped together, of course, outside then. You know, because now it doesn't matter. We're not in the building, so now we can all be clumped. But because he had served in the military, I believe in the Marine Corps, there were three Marines that were there when I arrived before the funeral. They were there before his remains arrived. He was cremated. Those Marines were there, stationed outside the building, waiting. And at the end of Mass, they brought out his remains in the urn, and his grandson wheeled his grandmother, Mrs. Felix, up near the pull-in area right in front of the church. And I came out, and one of the Marines was playing taps on the trumpet, and the other two had the flag. And their every movement, the positioning of their fingers on the corners of the flag, the precision with which their clothes had been prepared, the precision with which the hats had been placed upon their heads, the way that they folded in exact symmetry, mirroring each other, the way that the flag came together, the way that they folded carefully, slowly, deliberately, the flag into triangles, corner by corner, not worrying about whether or not someone was being inconvenienced because it was taking too long, but taking their deliberate time to do something that has enormous meaning in the folding of a flag into this triangular shape as these two Marines came closer and closer together. And when the flag was finally in the triangle shape, then each of the Marines then took turns inspecting the corners and the fold, feeling every edge of this flag in a very rhythmic way. It wasn't like, okay, that, it's not like when you make the bed and you're like, ah, that corner's tucked in. Okay, yeah, all right, you're good to go. It was very specific, the way that they ran their fingers along the edges. And then with one hand on top of the folded flag and one hand below, one of the Marines would hand it to the other Marine, and then that Marine took it and flipped it around and then turned and marched in a, he didn't walk directly to Mrs. Felix. He walked perpendicular to her and then turned facing her and then marched forward. Every movement, every step had a meaning and it had a purpose. And you couldn't hear a sound at that moment, even though the wind was buzzing and there were birds out and then there were, you know, insects all around. And you could probably even hear traffic. I couldn't hear any of it. All I could hear was the footsteps of that Marine walking to Mrs. Felix and then taking a knee in front of her and saying, "We thank you for the service of your husband." And handing her that flag. And you can't see something like that without being emotionally impacted. Even if you don't know that woman, like I do, who's been there my entire life, receiving the flag that represented the man that I knew my whole life. And that reverence of the flag and the desire to have that reverence at Mass. To have that reverence when we walk into the sanctuary. To have that reverence when the priest elevates the host. To have that reverence when the deacon walks to the ambo to proclaim the gospel. To have that reverence when the choir sings. To have that reverence so that when we are in that sacred space, every motion, every action, everything that we utter out of our mouths should make us feel like you do when you see a flag being folded and presented to a widow. That there is something special happening at each and every Mass that we attend. And that's why we're spending so much time in recent weeks. Because we can't come out of this coronavirus the same as we were before. This is an opportunity for us to experience greater reverence. And we can still have fun and do it, but there's time and a place for that, right? we're still going to joke around on the podcast, but we're spending deliberately more time on these things because, and again, I know that Jennifer is now a much older 50-year-old than I am in my young 49-year-old state. But I very much feel that I have fewer years ahead of me than I have behind me. And I want to make sure that I am doing whatever I can to help build up the kingdom of God in whatever little time I have left. And I just think about that flag and what a beautiful thing that was. And I'm speaking to whatever priests and bishops are listening and deacons. Your movements matter to us who are watching. Your every movement of your sacred hands, your every elevation of every Eucharist, your every approach to every altar, the reverence which you model for us matters because you're modeling for us the way that we are to go into worshiping our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. If you would do Mr. Felix a favor, will you please say a prayer for the repose of his soul and for comfort for his wife and children?
Back in the month of April of 2020, if you remember, dear listener, we were still in the throes of a more shelter-in-place, quarantine kind of a lifestyle. During that phase of our COVID-19 life, I distinctly remember taking advantage of the extra time to do reading, research, extra prayers, anything to sort of fill the void of no longer having access to physically attending Catholic Mass. And during that month in particular, I remember watching more YouTube videos than I probably have ever watched in my life, but looking for information about our faith, anything to answer the questions that were on everyone's minds. And there was one video in particular that caught my attention because it was featuring Dr. Scott Hahn as a guest for John Henry Weston back when the coronavirus was still somewhat new. I mean, April 21st, there were still a lot of questions being asked. And in that interview, John Henry Weston asked Dr. Scott Hahn point blank, "Do you think COVID-19 is a chastisement from God?" And with a question like that, I definitely wanted to hear what Dr. Scott Hahn had to say, what his thoughts were. But in that interview, again, this is late April of this year, he was praising the courageous leadership of three bishops in particular, which also caught my eye. He was praising the courageous leadership for Cardinal Raymond Burke, Archbishop Vigano, and Bishop Athanasius Schneider. Now, up until this point, I had only been familiar with the first two names, but it was the first time I heard the name Bishop Athanasius Schneider. And in this interview with Dr. Scott Hahn, which is also, there's a few articles that can be found over on LifeSite News about this interview with Dr. Scott Hahn. And as Dr. Hahn was answering the question about this pandemic being a natural consequence to the sinfulness of man, I would like to quote one paragraph from this blog article where Dr. Scott Hahn says, quote, "I think we have got to rethink almost everything from the ground up to realize that this Catholic faith is the only thing that will make sense out of our lives and our world and our own sins and the sinfulness of this world. And I believe that's exactly what Archbishop Vigano was getting at, as well as Cardinal Burke. And I say, Archbishop Schneider's book has opened my eyes to this as much as anything I've ever read. So thank you for pointing to those three good shepherds. There are a lot of others as well, thank God, but I'm not sure there are anyone who has been shepherding the flock as courageously as those three. And the book that Dr. Scott Hahn was referencing was none other than Christus Vincit, Christ's Triumph Over the Darkness of the Age, which was written by Bishop Athanasius Schneider. Dear listener, I have a great appreciation and love for Dr. Scott Hahn. We have several of his books in our home library. And Dr. Scott Hahn's more famous work, Rome Sweet Home, was very instrumental to Greg and myself many years ago in pulling us back into a greater fervor of the Catholic faith. When Dr. Scott Hahn got clearly excited about a book, you have to understand that I then was very curious as to find out, well, what kind of book would make Dr. Scott Hahn get excited? I want to know what that book is. So I clicked that link in that article so that I could learn more about this writing, Christus Vincit. And I knew without a doubt I was going to have to order that book immediately. So perhaps it was the first week of May. I ordered my copy. I started reading it and learning who Bishop Athanasius Schneider even is. What kind of man is he? What values does he preach in his style of communicating and transmitting the faith to the faithful? I was so touched and blown away by the ardent fervor this man clearly has for teaching the truth of our Lord Jesus Christ. It was very plain and easy to see that this is what this man wants to do. What he cares so deeply about is making sure our Lord gets the reverence he deserves. And that is all. That's exactly, dear listener, what I was looking for this pandemic. I wanted to make sense of it, and I knew the only thing I could focus on in the world that was turning upside down was I needed a focal point to keep me straight, and it's our Lord. It's our Lord. And the words, the writings of Bishop Athanasius Schneider was doing that for me. And I very joyfully sort of pondered his writings in my heart as we continue to navigate the trials of the quarantine and how our churches were responding to the quarantine and all of our locations throughout the world. And now we fast forward to the month of June as we are approaching the Feast of Corpus Christi. By now, in the month of June, not all, but many Catholic churches were reopening in an almost unrecognizable way, but they were reopening. And we were all excited to go back into the churches once again, but also nervous as to what it would look like, what it would feel like. But yet we went in faith. Now, towards the approaching of the Feast of Corpus Christi, I started to feel this burning desire within me to really do what I could to be as reverent as I could for our Lord. Something was changing in me over this pandemic, perhaps because I was denied the sacraments, denied the ability to pray inside of a church, denied the ability to go to Eucharistic adoration. So I was hungry and starving. And that's not a bad thing. It creates and can often lead to a zeal to want to be with our Lord, to be in communion with our Lord, to worship our Lord, to revere our Lord. So I was very excited to once again be inside the church this past June. At the same time, however, I was a little, or actually more than a little, quite a bit concerned when we were approaching the time of receiving the Eucharist and how it was being handled. I desperately wanted to continue receiving our Lord while kneeling and on the tongue. And dear listener, if you remember, before the pandemic came into our world, Greg and I were regularly sharing how we were making this transition. We were feeling called to revere our Lord by being on our knees more. It was just something that we were just starting to do when the churches closed. So I was very eager to want to return back to that new habit that I had just put into place. And it was a struggle because the priests were now being directed to not distribute Holy Communion to communicants kneeling and on the tongue. And I remember being confused by that and saddened by that, but I had the desire nevertheless. And I knew canon law is on the side of laity. It's on the side of us so that we can, in fact, make that request. But it was very apparent that there was a growing conflict and perhaps fear. I can't pretend to know what's in the hearts and minds of anyone else other than my own head. But the Eucharist was not going to be easily obtained in this reverent fashion. And while I do deeply appreciate priests who are taking the courageous steps to be creative in how to distribute the sacraments in a very holy, reverent way, I appreciate so much their willingness to do so and the risk that they might be taking up against their own superiors. But on the Feast of Corpus Christi, I was in a situation where I was given permission to function a little bit like a Eucharistic minister in that I was allowed to handle the consecrated host and offer the consecrated host myself to my children who would then kneel and receive our Lord on the tongue. Now think about what this looks like. I am a member of laity. I've never functioned in the capacity as a Eucharistic minister ever in my entire Catholic life. And in this moment, I had permission to do so. And then I just agreed because I was in the moment and I did not know what the laws were. And so there was this tendency to trust what you're being advised to do. And so I simply did it. And I prayed to God, said, Lord, if this is okay, please protect me. If it is wrong, convict me so that I will not do this again.
And again, in the middle of this, there are lots of questions by lots of people of how do we move forward when returning back to Mass with all the safety protocols that are being thrown around both from the church as well as the government, whether it be federal, state, or local. And so there's a lot of confusion, and priests are being told that in order to return back to Mass, that there has to be a limited amount of chairs, a limited amount of space between, or an expected amount of space between people, that every surface had to be wiped down after every Mass. And so the expectation was to acquire all sorts of cleaning materials that the church may not even be able to afford, may not have access to. How do you live up to all of these expectations and all these rules? And so sometimes when you have so many rules tossed at you, you do try to be creative and you try to find ways of accommodating as many people as possible. And we saw this, and you probably saw this online, but looking on what people are saying, what it was like for them to go back to their churches, wherever they may be. And we heard from so many people as they return back to churches, and there's parking lot masses, and there were drive-through reception of the Eucharist. And then in Europe, you're seeing some churches where priests even distributing wearing rubber gloves, which that seems problematic. And then as the weeks went on, we started seeing videos of people saying, okay, let's look at how many particles fall from the host when placed in the hand. Look at how many particles fall from the host and cling to a glove, which may just be discarded. How much reverence is being placed on the precious body of Jesus Christ? And then you see studies like what's coming out of Austria, where 24 Catholic medical professionals say with all clarity that receiving on the tongue is actually much safer and much more hygienic because the transmission of the virus is being done more so by hand transmission, where the hands touch bacteria and the virus is on the hand and it gets transmitted elsewhere, versus a priest, a single priest distributing the Eucharist, the chances are very low. The priest doesn't often touch a person's mouth or tongue. A priest has much more, and we've talked about this, has much more experience and understanding, care and love for distributing the Eucharist. And it's not to say that an extraordinary minister doesn't have a great love, but you have to give a priest some credit, a priest who's been highly trained, whose entire life has been given to providing the Eucharist, consecrating the Eucharist, bringing the Eucharist to us. A priest has that much more ability. And so one of the things that we kind of had hoped for was actually for a lessening of the use of extraordinary ministers of Most Holy Communion and an increase of priests saying it's going to take longer to distribute, but it's worth the time. It's going to require me as your pastoral father to take more time so that we can distribute the Eucharist as reverently as possible to as many people as possible and as safely as possible. And so again, taking into consideration all of these things, and then trying to understand what's our responsibility as recipients of the Most Holy Eucharist. How do we reverently act as disciples in honoring the Eucharist and being witnesses to other people and how we receive the Eucharist? And so all these things going through our minds. And we all, I think, have had our challenges during the coronavirus, as Jennifer said. And for us, praying the rosary so many nights, doing the live stream with our Rosary Army community, it did something to us. The Holy Spirit convicted us very strongly in the midst of all of this. And the prayers that we were being asked to lift up on behalf of all these people every night, and just this dire need in the middle of all of this, and so many people praying for return to the church by all of their family and friends who had fallen away. There was something, especially in the first early weeks of the coronavirus, so many people just desperately just pleading to God that God would bring their loved ones back into the church again. And all these things that just settled in our hearts and returned us, not that we ever left, but definitely clarified our focus once again on the source and summit of our faith, Jesus Christ and the Eucharist. There is nothing more important, period. There's nothing in our church more important. Not the singing, not the community, not the occasions that we can go to. I mean, it's just, I can't think of anything. I'm sitting here, I'm kind of stumbling. I can't think of any good examples that anything as important as the Eucharist. And so if the Eucharist is that important, let's use this as an opportunity to let ourselves be radically transformed into reverent disciples seeking radical holiness.
So in the swirl of that confusion in that moment, I participated in the liturgy of the Eucharist with the permission I was given, but I was convicted for the rest of that day. My spirit felt disturbed. I wasn't 100% sure if I was being as reverential to our Lord as I could be. Something was off and I didn't know what it was. And I wanted to verify, confirm, speak to someone who would know all of the teachings of the Eucharist and could advise me in this area. But I wasn't sure who to speak to. I didn't even know which priest I could call up or shoot a text over to. And I just prayed. I'm like, Holy Spirit, I need guidance. I need guidance. Who can I speak to about this particular matter of the most proper handling of the Holy Eucharist inside of Mass when there are communicants right before a priest and the Holy Eucharist. I need to know something about that moment and what can lady, you know, do or not do. I'm a little confused there and I don't know where to go. And I don't know if I trust my Google abilities to look this up online. And within moments, only one name came to mind as someone who could guide me. And that was Bishop Athanasius Schneider, whose book I was still reading. And I thought to myself, well, that is, quote, a Hail Mary pass, if there ever was one. I don't, you know, I went to his website, gloriadei.io, and on that website, I looked for a contact page, you know, anything that I could use to perhaps, you know, send a general email, general inbox. I was desperate for something, anything, any contact with this bishop in Kazakhstan, so far away from where we live here in the United States. And I found a little contact form, nothing fancy. I just filled it out and I provided very clear and concise facts of the events surrounding the handling of the Eucharist in that moment. Not because I was trying to get anyone, you know, in trouble. No names were mentioned.
Just
simply interested in
seeking clarity in the
guidance.
Confusion.
Yes, I want the truth here. Just tell me, is this valid? Is this licit? Is it legal? Is it correct? Is it reverent? And I will believe you. I trust your words because of what you've written and what you've said in your interviews. I know you are a man of God and you have a deep, deep love for the Holy Eucharist. I trust you. And I sent that email. I said a prayer and that was it. In the middle of the night, less than 12 hours later, I heard my phone buzz. I keep it on my nightstand. And usually I ignore it, but I was prompted to grab my phone and look at it. And I was elated, absolutely overjoyed to see that I was given a direct reply from the bishop himself. Because of his love of the Eucharist, he wanted to share and instruct and guide as the pastor that he is. And I so deeply appreciate his very frank and direct words with me. And they were very frank and very direct. But it also had such a truth behind it that I could not deny it. I could not deny it. And it was because of the writings of this bishop that has given me, Jennifer Willits, the courage to make a spiritual communion whenever I do not have access to receiving our Lord kneeling and on the tongue. Because now I know why I'm doing that and for whom I am doing this. It is not to make a rebellious move in front of my fellow parishioners, like, look, I'm not going to receive like you. That is not in my brain at all. The only thing I care about in that moment is the Lord, because it is the Lord, Dominus est. It is the Lord in the Eucharist before me. I need to kneel and be fed completely by him as a sign, a simple sign of respect and love for who he is. And I felt so overjoyed by the clear direction that this bishop gave that I've been able to sort of navigate this pandemic with that encouragement and share that and transmit that with the children. And then next thing you know, we attended a Latin Mass for the first time. And it's been this beautiful, organic development of a deepening of our faith that really just began with a desire to be more reverent to the Holy Eucharist itself. And look at where we are now. We have clearly gone, we've moved, we have traveled in our spiritual journey just since the Feast of Corpus Christi in mid-June. And I'm so excited to see where we're going. Like, I'm excited that we are scratching the surface of the beauty of understanding the traditional liturgy and to understand the church's history. And since that moment, since mid-June, I have continued to read Bishop Schneider's works. He wrote a very small and profound book called Dominus Est, It is the Lord. I highly recommend you order this small book. You could read it in an afternoon. It is powerful and humble at the same time. Never once do you feel like you are being yelled at. This man somehow strikes the tone of being like a loving, grandfatherly, pastoral man. He won't yell at you. He's just going to smile and just show you the beauty that's there so that you can naturally respond to the beauty that's right in front of you. He's just pointing you to Christ, pointing you to Christ. That's all I wanted. Just point me in the right direction. And so it is with a great honor that we were able to extend an invitation over to Bishop Schneider to ask him to be on our show. I wanted to have a more frank conversation along with Greg about all the conversations we've been having on our program these last couple of weeks, where we've been discussing communion on the tongue, communion on the hand, what is the more reverent way that we can receive our Lord. And I wasn't sure if the bishop would accept. I know he's a very busy man. He's being interviewed in several areas and places, but he said yes. And so we are delighted to be able to play this interview on this episode of Adventures in Imperfect Living. And it was just a delight, an absolute delight, to be able to speak to this man who clearly loves the Lord. And I hope that when you hear this interview, you will have a desire, like a fanning of the flame of faith inside your heart, that you will grow in your desire to be reverential in front of our Lord Jesus Christ, especially in the Eucharist, because he is here. Jesus is in the tabernacles of the world in the Holy Catholic Church. We have all that we need to survive this world. Let us bow down in front of our Lord. And I am so grateful to just reading that article back in April where Dr. Scott Hahn just mentioned this bishop in Kazakhstan who just happened to read this book. And I just clicked that link and just one thing led to another. And here we are today. We're very happy to bring to you Bishop Athanasius Schneider.
Your Excellency, would you mind starting us with a prayer before our discussion?
Yes. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Well, it is such an honor today. We really do appreciate your time. And, you know, one of the things, and we tried to share this with you in email that we sent, was a lot of our audience is just dealing with a lot of confusion right now. We're experiencing it in our own home. We have so many people, you know, when people listen to our show, a lot of times they describe it as listening to friends who are trying to figure out how to make their way in the world while living out their faith. But we haven't always had the best foundations from which to do that. So when we start hearing different things about how we receive the Eucharist, particularly in the time of coronavirus, all these things, there's just a lot of confusion. And so, you know, even before we start, I like the idea of sort of beginning and ending our conversation with encouragement for everyone that's listening. If just right out of the gate, if someone is feeling discouragement in general, just about their faith, what would you say to them?
Yes, a person who is believing has no reason to be a lack of courage, because the Lord is always with us. The Lord said, I am always with you. And so we have not to fear, not to be discouraged in no way, because we have the Lord and he is with us. And we have the faith. We know the Catholic faith. We have the catechisms. And this Catholic faith, no one can take us away. No one. It is our treasure in our soul, And so we have to the Lord, we have the Catechism, we have the Eucharist, even though in these coronavirus limitations we have not all and everywhere have always access to the Holy Eucharist, but at least we can go to the church in front of the tabernacle and visit our living Lord who is there with his living heart, with his divine heart in the tabernacle, in every Catholic church we can go. And so we have all the means which we need. And so this is for me a desire to encourage all of you to be to remember this, to remind this, because I myself spent my childhood in a persecuted church, in an underground church in the Soviet Union. We were persecuted. We were living our faith in the families hidden oftentimes. We had very rarely access to the sacraments, but we kept the joy of our faith in our house, in the domestic church. And sometimes the priest came hidden secretly, and this was a quiet feast for us. And then we confessed, we received the Holy Communion, and then the priest left the Holy Eucharist, some hosts, with a very trustworthy person, oftentimes a good mother of family, and she kept the Blessed Sacrament, as my grand aunt, the sister of my grandfather, and she kept in her house hidden behind a screen. And then in the first Saturday, in the first Fridays, we came secretly to make adoration in the house of my grand aunt, and she opened the box, and we saw our Lord, and we made adoration in secret. It was secret, and this gave us a lot of strength and forth. And at least I think we have in these difficult times, it is good to read about the martyrs, to read stories about the martyrs, to read stories about the persecuted church. This gives us, again, courage and conviction of our faith and joy.
Your Excellency, out of a desire for greater reverence, especially during this time of the coronavirus pandemic, personally, I have felt like this pandemic has given me, and I believe other Catholics, particularly in the country, the United States of America, an awareness that something is wrong. There's some spiritual, something that isn't sort of connecting to what we thought we understood as the true deposit of the faith. And I feel as if I'm waking up now to seeing that there is a better and more reverent way of worshiping our Lord, when all I have ever known and all many of us Catholics in America have ever known is what we were taught in the last 50 years. There's like a greater awareness of the Latin Mass, for instance, which is something very new to my husband and myself and to other Catholics that we personally know. Because all we've ever known is the Novus Ordo presentation of the liturgy. But once we experienced one Latin Rite Mass, we have felt and deeply touched and moved by what we experienced, that now we are a little confused as to what we have been experiencing for the last several decades in comparison to what was exposed to us in the Latin Rite Mass. And we are at this really interesting juncture in our spirituality where we, out of a desire for greater reverence, how do we reconcile the two different rites of the liturgy? What do we do? I feel a little spiritually jarred and confused, perhaps. And I know there are some who listen to our program who feel a little similarly. What do we do going forward once we know that there are two different rites of the Mass?
Or actually more than that.
And more,
all the rites,
actually.
All the rites.
But in this country, there's a greater access to the Novus Ordo, definitely the most, and then very few of the Latin rite access. How can we reconcile the two going forward?
First, I would like to consent to you, Mr. Willits, that you said there are more than two forms. Oftentimes, all over the world, you can discover in every parish another rite. This is so. Because the new Novus Ordo is, in its structure already, open to diversity, to some subjective manner of celebration. This, the Novus Ordo has some, the structure itself is so unclear and open to improvisation even. And so therefore, the Novus Ordo in its structure itself is problematic because of this unclearness and of this openness to introductions of subjective manners of celebration and words and on. This is a fact which we witnessed in the 50 years. But I would like to say that it is a grace that God gave you to discover the richness of the church liturgy. It is the liturgy of our mother church, the traditional rite, as we had it and now have still, thanks be to God. It is this manner which was which matured through centuries as a mature, beautiful flower for the greater honor of God. It was matured by the prayers and wisdom of so many saints, of so many doctors of the church, all not only for 50 years. The Novus Ordo is only 50 years. What is this? It's 2,000 years. It's nothing in comparison. And the traditional form which we have, it is proven by documents. It is at least 1,000 years. Imagine, 1,000 years. Not 50 years, not 100 years, not 200 years, not 500 years, more. It is not the Tridentine Mass. It is wrong, because I possess a copy of a Roman Missal printed in 1470, 100 years before the Council of Trent. You can read that. And there is the order of the Mass the same. It's no difference. So, this is not a Tridentine Mass. It is the Mass of the old Roman tradition, the Mass of the old ancient Roman tradition, not of the Council of Trent. Nothing to do. The Council of Trent only asked the Pope that he may imprint a new missal and make some corrections in some things which were overloaded by prefaces or some the calendar and so on, but not to change the structure of the Mass, nothing. Therefore, the Catholics, before the Council of Trent and after the Council of Trent, there were no rupture. They even did not discover a new Mass. There were no. There were never in the Church in 2,000 years a new Mass, never. This is a fact. We have to recognize this. There was only a slow, very slowly organic grows of the manner of celebration, very careful, maybe in 300 years was changed or added one word or one expression, but very careful. It was like growing a flower. And so many saints, at least this message we have, it goes to St. Gregory the Great, Pope, in the beginning of the seventh century. And therefore, some scholars call the traditional Mass, the Latin Mass, the Mass of St. Gregory the Great. Of course, not exactly in every detail, but the structure was substantially, of the order of the Mass, substantially from Gregory the Great. And then, in the form which we have now, it is at least and exactly 1,000 years. At least we have St. Francis from Assisi in the 13th century. The Franciscans already celebrated the Mass as the same manner, even with the prayer at the foot of the altar and so on, which we have now. Imagine, so many generations of saints grew up with this form of celebration of Mass, were nourished spiritually by this form, St. Francis and the other saints which we know, St. Teresa and so on. All the saints of this time, of the past, more or less past millennium. And so, and then our Lord said, by the fruits, you will recognize them. The fruits. The new Mass, it is evident, it brought more or less confusion or a diminution, increasing of expression of sacredness, of sublimity, of the mystery, and so on. It is evident. And gave place to subjectivity. And so these are not the fruits. And then, the Novus Ordo, it is not the Mass of the Vatican II, please. No. It is not the Mass of Vatican II. It is the contrary. It was a revolution which was made after the Council against the indications of Vatican II. This is a historical fact that we have to stress. I give you now the examples and the proof. For example, it was the first new Mass, Novus Ordo, in 65, in January 65. Still during the Vatican Council, because the Vatican Council ended in December 65. Mm. And in January 65, it was promulgated, or in March, in the beginning of 65, a new Ordo Missae, a new Mass, according to the indications of the Second Vatican Council. And you know what was this Mass, which shape she had? Almost the same as the traditional Mass. Mm. There was very few changes. For example, there was no more the Psalm 42 at the beginning of the Mass. The Psalm 42 was dropped then in the last Gospel of John. And the rest was not touched by the Reform. No, it was not touched. Only the changes, as I repeat, was this, the Psalm 42, the beginning of the Mass, but this was not a radical change. Because why? Because even before the Vatican II, in all the Masses for the deceased, departed, the Requiem Masses, they had no Psalm 42. They were said without the Psalm 42. All the Requiem Masses before the Council. And then the last weeks before Easter also, there was no Psalm 42. Therefore, this was not a radical novelty to drop the Psalm 42, for example. And then the other changes was the main change was not the structure of the Mass, but the language. So in 65, it was allowed to take the vernacular language in the Mass, the vernacular, because before it was only Latin, as you know, as now in the... And so the entire Mass could be celebrated in the vernacular language, with the exception of the central part of the Mass. It was the preface and the canon of the Mass. It was still kept in Latin, obligatory in Latin, 65. So starting with the preface in Latin, Dominus vobiscum sursum corda, it was all in Latin in 65, until the per ipsum. And so this, the heart of the Mass, the heart, the canon, the consecration was in Latin and always silently, as today in the Latin Mass. And the rest could be in the vernacular language. Wow. So it was all. There was no more changes. And therefore, the Council Fathers, when they returned in September 65 for the last session of the Council, they were happy with this liturgical reform. They said this is a very careful reform. This is good. This is according to our, which we decided. And so no one was thinking that this will be changed again in a radical form. Mm-hmm. So we had already the Novus Ordo in 65. Very close to the old Mass, almost as I now explained to you. And then came the tragedy, the revolution after the Council, against the prescription of the Council. Now I tell you, in 67, 2 years after the Council, it was the first Synod of Bishops in Rome celebrated. And the Monsignor Bugnini, he was the architect of the new Mass. He was already the secretary of the Commission of the Reform. And he presented to the Synod Fathers the draft of the Novus Ordo. Again, another change, a radical change. And he presented to them exactly the same Novus Ordo which we now have. He presented them in 67, 2 years after the Council. 2 years after there was already a Novus Ordo. Why? In 65 was already made a reform of the Mass according to the indications of the Vatican Council. Why in 2 years later make a completely new revolution? And it did. And so, but here, the majority of the bishops in the Synod of 67 in Rome rejected this draft, rejected our Novus Ordo. It was rejected, not accepted. And nevertheless, notwithstanding the rejection of the Novus of the draft in 67. In 69, 2 years later, Paul VI implemented this and forced the entire church to accept this new revolutionary Mass, Novus, which we now have, which I repeat was rejected by the majority of the bishops in 67. And they were all still participants of the Vatican Council, because only 2 years after. And then they were against the spirit and the prescription of the Sacrosanctum Concilium, when you carefully read this. In any case, it was a revolution. And now we have 50 years, this revolutionary Novus Ordo, which was not, which is really against the 65 Vatican II Mass. And even the 65 Vatican II Mass was accepted by Archbishop Lefebvre. Mm. And Archbishop Lefebvre celebrated the 65 Vatican II Mass. 10 years until 75, and then only when Rome suspended him and started to suspended him, then only Archbishop Lefebvre in 75 returned to the Mass of 62 before the Council, which we now have the traditional Latin Mass. So these are facts. We have to recognize this, and no one can reject these facts. Mm-hmm. But we have to have patience, and the Church is moving slowly by the categories of centuries, not of decades. And so the providence of God gave us this Pope Benedict XVI, this miracle, historical miracle, that in 2007 he extended the Mass of all ages, this millennium Mass, which always was, to the entire Church. And he said in his motu proprio, Summorum Pontificum, that the traditional form of the Mass has to be the same rights and the same dignity as the Novus Ordo, and cannot be discriminated in the Church. So these are words from Benedict the 16th, and thanks be to God, Benedict the 16th, with the motu proprio, he initiated, I would say, a good spiritual revolution in the Church. The old Mass, as people say, became the Mass for the youth, the teenager Mass, the children Mass, the Mass of all ages. And the traditional Mass is the true Mass for the children. The children love this Mass. I know I oftentimes celebrate it with children, the traditional Mass. Even, I tell you now, in my book I wrote this, Christus Vincit, but I repeat this. I was 4 years ago in Africa, in Tanzania, and I visited a community of sisters who have the old rites still, the traditional Mass, in Africa, Africans. And they have a boarding school with girls. And then I celebrated the traditional Mass for them. And the entire school of the girls, 100 girls or more, they were participating every morning in the Mass. And all the children asked me all the answers in Latin, perfect Latin, they answered me. With so joy, the African children, from the first grade, they answered me all the answers in Latin with a perfect pronunciation. I was moved. And then I said, these little African children, they know better Latin than priests and bishops. This is a fact. So it was the Mass of children. Then I celebrate, and evermore you know that young people, especially young men, love the traditional Mass, because this is a Mass of order. It's order of hierarchy. And young men, they love this, because this is similar in some way to the military discipline. It is beautiful. It has order. It has hierarchy. And so the entire life, and God created the entire creation with hierarchy, with beauty. And so the order, the old liturgy is reflecting in some way the beauty of the creation of God, the hierarchy, the subordination, the mystery also, no, to silence, and so on. And then the old Mass is also the Mass of the old people. So, and the young people, and the children, and all. So it is the Mass of the entire family. Mm-hmm. We have not to celebrate teen Masses with guitars and so on, or children Masses with shows and kindergarten style. No, we have to celebrate one Mass for the entire family, grandparents, parents, teenagers, children, and even babies. All are there. And all are participating in the Mass of all ages.
Your Excellency, you said so much in that that I want to comment on, but I want to sort of hone in on a few things. Talking about the church moves more in centuries than decades, there's that part. But then also knowing that for Jennifer and I, for example, born in 1970, we grew up surrounded by the Catholic Church of the 1970s. And so as a result of that, it wasn't until our 20s that we started really diving into church history and having a more solid understanding of our faith. But so many people have had the Novus Ordo is the way that they know Catholicism. And a lot of people are listening right now and they're thinking, okay, well, this sounds wonderful. This traditional Latin Mass sounds wonderful. But is that to say that the Novus Ordo that I have lived my entire life as a Catholic as doesn't have meaning, that there's nothing spiritually beneficial there? Someone might be thinking that, and they may also be a little discouraged because, for example, in the United States, I'm sure you know this, the fraternity of Saint Pius the Tenth. With the order, the FSSP, not the St. Pius X, but the FSSP, that particular, thank you. There's only a handful of dioceses, a handful of priests, a handful of parishes where the traditional Latin Mass throughout all of North America, you know, Canada and the United States. And so someone might be discouraged and think, well, my priest doesn't know the traditional Latin Mass. He's not going to celebrate it. I don't know how to approach my priest about this. I don't want to leave my parish. I want to be a part of my community. All these questions that are coming up, right? So it's a beautiful idea. Someone might feel discouraged because how do we implement this, particularly when we rarely hear the, and again, I'm sorry to keep just focusing on the United States, but the USCCB, for example, or other Catholic bishops' conferences aren't encouraging this, aren't really promoting this, despite the fact that, as you mentioned, in 2007, His Holiness Benedict XVI encouraged this. So a little bit of encouragement for people who are confused. They think, well, am I not spiritually benefiting from the Mass that I go to on Sundays? And how do they kind of move forward to possibly this rich experience of the traditional Latin Mass that you're talking about?
Yes. I understand this very good. And what I told before, it was only the objective content, the objective. Of course, I understand very good that these people grow up and they do not know other things. And of course, you can also have benefit from the Novus Ordo. It depends how you are participating. This is another aspect now. Before we spoke about the objective content and aspect, of course, you can also participate distracted in the Old Mass, and also priests can celebrate the Old Mass not worthiful and distracted and so on, and they will not have so much spiritual benefit. So it depends on you. How you deeply participate. Of course, the Novus Ordo is a valid Catholic Mass. I mean, when it is celebrated, I have to add according to the rubrics. Maybe there are some places where the Novus Ordo is very doubtfully, if it is valid. There are several places. But I say a good diocesan parish, it's normally celebrated, it is validly. And you can participate there deeply with devotion and faith, believing that here is Jesus Christ, and this is the renewal of the sacrifice of Golgotha, and he is present, our Lord, and I will receive him. You have the right to receive him kneeling under the tongue, even in the Novus Ordo, and then go to adoration and so on. When there is no other possibility, you can use this, but there is more. The old liturgy, as we explained, is objectively richer of gestures, of prayers. And when the people start to meditate these, they will have more I think, spiritual benefit of them. And then I repeat, take the Novus Ordo, they can participate and they will have their spiritual benefit. But the other way, they can receive even more. Why not? To give the Lord what we can, more, not the minimum, but more. And this is the traditional way. And therefore, I think that these people, when there is no mass, of course, in your vicinity, close to you, then you have to accept these, or at least in periodically, or you can travel to a place where there is celebrated the traditional mass. It depends where you are living, of course. But at least what I would say, Pope Benedict said that both forms can enrich mutually one another. And I think that the meaning also that of the traditional mass is now allowed is also that the Novus Ordo could be improved in the celebration. And this is also telling Cardinal Robert Sarra. Oftentimes he repeated this, and Pope Benedict told this when he was Cardinal Ratzinger, to improve the Novus Ordo. Therefore we have to look to the traditional mass to improve the Novus Ordo. Why not? You can celebrate the Novus Ordo face to the Lord. Ad orientem, it is allowed. And why not? You can receive in the Novus Ordo also people all kneeling in the tongue. You can celebrate in Latin also, and so on. You have not to have female altar service. You have not to have extraordinary Eucharistic ministers and so on, or female readers. This is not necessary for the Novus Ordo. So you can improve, maybe to tell your priest, improve slowly also the Novus Ordo. And I believe that by time, the Holy Spirit will move the Novus Ordo closely to the old rite by time. That we are going in this direction slowly. So,
Your Excellency, please, does the laity have any authority or right to confront their local priest about a desire to see these changes that you just talked about? It seems as if we don't have a right to approach our priest out of respect for his position, that we would not be taken seriously. How do you want to encourage laity to speak up out of reverence for Christ to their priest?
Of course. Of course, you say this is your right. The canon law, there is a canon law, a canon that says that the lay people have the right to express to their shepherds their desires, their proposals for the benefit of the church. This is your right, which the church gives you, and especially the Vatican II encouraged lay people to make propositions, proposals for the benefit of the church, to the hierarchy, even to the Pope. And this is because we are a family in the church. We are not we are not a worldly association with a boss and with his employees. We are a family in the church. And of course, the priest is the father, and the bishop is the father, and the pope is the father. But you are faithful, you can, with respect, but with clarity, propose then what is better for the mass or for the other topics, for the catechesis and so on, for the pastoral life. This is an improvement which Vatican II brought us. Because before the Vatican II, it was not so recognized, but after, and then you can say, when your parish priest say, you have to shut up, you have nothing to say to me, this is not your competency, you can say, Reverend Father, I'm implementing the spirit of Vatican II. Oh. Vatican II.
You have to listen to me now.
I am doing only what Vatican II encouraged us lay people to go to the priests, to the bishops, and to them our proposals. So, and because even Pope Francis, you know, oftentimes he criticized the so-called clericalism. Clericalism, you know. And clericalism is a behavior when a priest, a bishop, says, I am the boss and you have to obey and you have to silence. This is clericalism and this is bad. And so you have to say, dear Father, maybe we should not promote clericalism, but a cooperation and so, and a good priest, he will be grateful for your proposals. He will be thankful to you.
To that point, Your Excellency, I would like to move the conversation a little more to the Eucharist itself and how to most reverently receive our Lord in the Holy Eucharist. As I know, you've recently, you've been on many interviews we're on this very topic of communion on the hand versus communion on the tongue. And we are absolutely in a very difficult situation in this country, magnified by the challenge of the coronavirus and how that has affected how the church is sort of imposing restrictions on the laity. We are in a situation now that if we do not agree to receive our Lord in Holy Communion standing and on the hand, we will be denied. I personally experienced this with my children. Just a few days ago, I remained kneeling because I refused to stand out of pure reverence, not to be like in opposition to government or anything grand like that. It was just out of a desire to be reverent to who was before me in the Eucharist, and I remained kneeling. But deacons and priests have been given power, authority, if you will.
Or even succumb to fear.
Or even perhaps succumb to fear of retribution from their superiors, their archbishops.
Or their parishioners.
To not give our Lord to anyone kneeling and on the tongue. So we are just simply, the hand goes over the ciborium, I believe, that contains all the consecrated hosts, and we are just given a blessing and they walk away from us. Or sometimes they ignore us completely. And so I tell my children, we must make a spiritual communion at this time. That's all we have. But it feels particularly painful when the priest and or deacon and our Lord in the Eucharist is literally only a few feet away from us, but we cannot receive him. Should we continue to go to Mass in this way? Or is it better to stay home and be reverent at home and watch the Mass online, which is growing in popularity in this country because of the pandemic? What would you say to that, Your Excellency?
First, Mrs. Willits, I would like to congratulate you for your witness of faith. And I'm convinced that our Lord will reward you. Once in heaven, you will come and our Lord will say to you, oh, Jennifer, remember this time you confessed me before the people, even before the deacon, before the priest. You had not fear. And he will say to you, and to others, he will say, you had not the courage to confess me in church. You were fearful. You were not kneeling. I am convinced the Lord will say this. And so continue. This is a gift of God which he gave to your heart to confess him, to adore him, even at the extent, at the price, to be humiliated. But take this. You will receive more spiritual graces, I'm convinced. And the Lord will fill your heart with the graces of the spiritual communion when you are not receiving on the hand. And therefore continue. And this is the first. Then practically, well, it would be better, of course, to assist a real mass, because it is not the same as on television or on YouTube. At least when the mass is worthily celebrated, the Novus Ordo. Even so, you are not going to communion, you can assist the mass. You know that in the previous centuries, let us say from the entire second millennium, the people received very rarely Holy Communion during the year, maybe twice or three times, four times during the year. Even St. Francis and so on. I'm not encouraging this, please understand me right. But I'm only saying to for your information, to comparison. And these saints, they were great saints. Even they were not receiving communion, the sacramentally form, so oftentimes. And therefore, you can assist Mass and then no go to Holy Communion if they will force you to receive on in the hand. And then you can maybe once a month make a trip, a journey, to a place where you are knowing that there you will receive communion kneeling. And there are places.
Yes.
And so, and then once a month you can make a Eucharistic trip for Holy Communion.
A pilgrimage.
And this will be very, a pilgrimage, yes, to Holy Communion. And this will be very, to my opinion, very, rich, spiritually, very rich. And so do this. And then, of course, you can again go to the priest and say, please, can you give me maybe after Mass privately the Holy Communion or kneeling in the tongue privately? Maybe it could be a compromise after the Mass when all gone away. Can you give me? Maybe. When he's a good priest, he has to do this when he is a shepherd. Because even it is proven by many scholars and scientists, it's proven that the communion in hand, it's not hygienic, it's anti-hygienic. Because the palm of the hand and the fingers are full of bacteria and so on. And they are dangerous. Then you will touch the Holy Host and transport these bacteria of your fingers in your mouth. Mm-hmm. But when you receive directly in the mouth, there are no more the danger, the transmission of bacteria of your hands. And then it is rarely that a priest touches your tongue or your lips. It is rarely. But even if he will do this, then he can purify his fingers and disinfect. So there are priests, many priests from the in Germany, from the fraternity of St. Peter, in the old rite, where the bishops prohibit even communion on the tongue for the old masses in some in the old German dioceses, unfortunately, then these priests, they make the following compromise. It takes time, but it is worthwhile for our Lord. So they make so. Some I know. They have two little vessels, one with pure water and the other with disinfection, some disinfection liquid. And then before every communion, they give the tongue. After every communion, they purify the fingers because there could be some fragment, particle in the pure water. And then in the disinfection liquid, because you cannot put our Lord in the disinfection, it is against the reverence, I mean. But first in the water, the particle, and then disinfection. And then you dry your fingers, and then take the host and give. And so every time, this every communicant this. It takes time, it is long, but I think that this is our Lord is worthy of this. He is worthy of this.
And I love that phrase that our Lord is worthy of the extra time, the extra effort. And it's so
fun. And these efforts, he is worthy.
Yeah.
And even we take these complicated, even because the bishops prohibit, but in any case, this is my suggestion, my counsel as to your question. Well, you can drive to make a pilgrimage, Eucharistic pilgrimage.
Okay, I have another important question on behalf of our audience. We have a lot of listeners to this program who are older than all of us. Okay, we have many Catholics who truly care about their faith and they want to grow deeper in their faith. And there has been a lot of attention lately on receiving communion, kneeling, and on the tongue. And just as a word of comfort, perhaps, to these older Catholics who have struggles with their health and they want to desperately kneel before our Lord in the Eucharist, but they struggle with kneeling, there has been some confusion on the part of the laity as to what would be an appropriate way of handling that lack of ability to kneel physically. What do you recommend? There has been some confusion as to should they stand, should they remain seated? How can they receive if they cannot kneel because of health?
It is evident when a person cannot kneel, our Lord is understanding, and they can receive him with the interior devotion. The interior devotion has always to be present in every moment of receiving Holy Communion. And when a person is physically not able to kneel, it is logic and is normal that he can't standing. And then he is kneeling inside. He is kneeling in his heart. He can always kneel in his heart and make a spiritual adoration interiorly. Or even sitting when you are sick and lying in your bed, and the priest is coming, giving the communion to the sick people or to the dying people. They are receiving the lying on the bed and adoring him and kneeling in the spirit. It is no problem. It is evident.
Thank you, Your Excellency.
We're so appreciative of your time and your encouragement to people that are listening, and particularly in this time of pandemic and lockdowns and changes in our churches and everything, to give people hope that the church is not necessarily going stagnant, but the opposite. The church has so much area where it is just blossoming because of the reverence that people are placing on the Eucharist. So thank you for being here. We'd like to give you the last word, if there's anything that you would like to say to our listeners, as well as if you would offer a prayer and a blessing, we would appreciate that.
First, I would like to thank you for your witness and to encourage you to continue to love evermore our holy Catholic faith, to keep them, to deepen the faith, to confess our Lord, to not to be fearful, and to be happy to confess our Lord. And to transmit to others what you experience in your heart, the beauty of our faith, the greatness of God and Jesus in the Holy Mass, in the Holy Liturgy of all ages. And do these, to be apostles also of Jesus in a way what you can. And transmit the love and the truth, all of us together. And live in hope. And so I will encourage you to continue and to be, I would also encourage you to participate in the crusade of the Eucharistic prayer, which I published, you know, of the reparation to Eucharistic heart of Jesus. Join these. And so we are forming an army. A powerful army, but a powerful army of the little ones. in the church. And so we are proud of our littleness, not of our greatness. We have no power. We have no influence in the administration structures and so on in the church. But we have another influence. We have an influence with prayer. And so we are united, and therefore I would like to encourage you. And then I give you the blessing. Now we pray, and then I give you the blessing. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. May be the prayer of the angel of Fatima. We can pray together. My God, I believe, I adore, I trust, I love you. I beg your pardon for those who do not believe, do not adore, do not trust, and do not love you. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning,
is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And may the Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Your Excellency.
Praise be our Lord Jesus Christ,
now and forever.
And forever.
Amen. 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 There's really no way that we can adequately wrap up that conversation. All the things we've said on this podcast, we pray and we hope that it has benefited you in your spiritual life, in your daily prayer life. And we encourage you, if you have questions, take it to prayer. Go to your church. Go to adoration, as Bishop Schneider recommended. Spend time in front of Jesus and bring to him your concerns. I have every confidence that our Lord Jesus Christ, our Savior, through the Holy Spirit, will guide you closer to him if you ask him to do so. So thank you to Bishop Schneider for being on our program. We are just so humbled and so thankful for your pastoral advice and for being so willing and accommodating to answering Jennifer's zillion questions, because as priests around the world have learned, Jennifer Willits has a lot of questions and is not afraid to ask them. So with that, thank you so much for being here. Thank you to our co-producers at patreon.com/Greg and Jennifer who make this happen. Please consider prayerfully signing up and being one of our co-producers. But if you're not in a place or are able to do so, will you please do us a favor? Keep our family in your prayers. Pray for our marriage. Pray for our children. Pray for the Rosary Army ministry, that we will continue to be able to do all that God is calling us to do. We are so glad that you are along with us on this journey, these adventures in imperfect living. You are awesome.
And you are not alone.
Till next week, God bless, friends.